Well, it's very moving.
I must have seen a documentary about survivors of the Battle of the Somme.
I'm feeling bad, and these so-and-sos, they haven't helped me a bit.
I saw this particular guy, and I was deeply moved by him, Alf Rozelle, who tells this story about a wounded comrade. They're captured by the Germans, and he tries to carry him with him to wherever they're going, presumably to a German prisoner of war compound.
He said, "I can't go any further, let me die." I said, "If I leave you here, Bill, you won't be found. Let's have another go." He said, "All right then." But the same thing happened. He couldn't stand it anymore, and the Germans were beginning to swear at me because I was delaying them. And I had to leave him there, in no man's land.
He never forgets about it, and he goes back 60 years later or something and sees Bill Hubbard's name written in the little book of Commonwealth Graves Commission Cemetery. And he feels better about it because he knows that he was found. He comes in at the end of the song amused to death.
Seeing his name and his name on the memorial, it sort of lightened my heart, if you like.
I'm what's called a radical atheist. Well, obviously nobody knows anything, whatever your attachment to something up there is. My belief is that that is almost certainly a malign influence on your life. I think it interferes with you confronting some of the questions that I think are fundamental, both philosophically and politically, to all of us. Muhammad was probably a perfectly reasonable, good guy, but he did also claim, I believe, that God had spoken to him and got him to write shit down. That's where the problem comes, because what you're telling people is that there is a supreme power and I am the only conduit to him. If it's true, that must mean that only one small group of people actually have a God. Radical atheism is sort of being on the side of Stephen Hawking or Richard Dawkins or these very bright people who write books, but they travel around the world, as well as going, faith is not a great basis for making decisions on what you're going to do in the future if you're concerned about the in order to make things better for your children and grandchildren.
The monkey sat on a pile of stone.
The monkey is me and you and all of us, obviously. It's satire rather than cynicism. And it's saying, if we were allowed to go to school and if our government spent the kind of money that they do on building weapons to go and kill brown people, in the pretense of keeping us safe, which is only a pretense, actually what they're doing is they're protecting the interests of oil companies and other multinational corporations. I know I'm sounding a bit conspiracy theory here, but fuck it, I don't care, because it's the truth. If we spent that money on educating our children, not to prepare themselves for lives as consumers, but to prepare themselves to become adults who think about things, who have open minds. I wrote this 23 years ago, but it's what I saw then and it's what I see now. The time has come to move forward.
You have a natural tendency to squeeze up and shut.
The bravery of being out of range. Yeah, that's a song about Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan is a great hero in this country, still, to an awful lot of people. Ronald Reagan was an extraordinarily malign influence on the lives of millions of people all over the world. And I think he epitomizes a lot of what is wrong with the political systems in the world. I'm not saying that I would have preferred to have been living in the USSR. Clearly, to live in a country where you're not allowed to leave is appalling, and this is something that people are always pointing out to me. Just because I pick holes sometimes in the system of imperial capitalism that operates in this country, that's not that I think that somebody on the other side of some wall got it right, and so you're wrong and they're right. That's not what I think at all. I actually think that what is wrong is that any of us allow ourselves to put ourselves in a position where we point the finger at other people and say, I'm the good guy, he's the bad guy, now I get to do whatever the fuck I like.
Standing at the window, a farmer's wife in Oxfordshire.
It must have been close to the very first time that we decided to go and bomb Libya, because there's a song on there called Lay It Home Tonight, and it's all about American fighter bombers taking off in England and flying to Libya and dropping bombs on the capital, killing people, because Gaddafi had done something of which we disapproved, apparently. So the song is actually about the personal lives of the farmer in Oxfordshire, or the farmer's wife who sees the phantoms taxiing ready to go and take off on their mission, which they have no idea. Nobody has any idea where they're going or why they're going. And a woman in Tripoli being killed for reasons that she will never have any idea what it was about or what it was for.
Fly.